I think I'll get us started. This is just phenomenal. I really appreciate the response that we received. My name is Brian Blake. If you haven't already met me, I'm the Vice Provost for Academic Affairs and Dean of the Graduate School. And this is actually our first year attempting to do a student first year research guide. So two of the things that, you know, being my second year, two of the things that I really was interested in starting as Dean of the Graduate School was, one, I wanted to try to make sure that the community of graduate students were recognized amongst the entire student body. In addition, I wanted to try to enhance that community. Two is that I wanted to try to make sure that the University of Miami is pushing very significantly toward being a strong research one institution. So I want to make sure that graduate students have the best support possible to engage in research in ways that are most effective. So this is one of our attempts at the latter, to try to make sure that you have all the information you need to be most successful at your graduate program. So we're starting about 10 minutes late, so I'm going to try to put on my, I've been learning speed reading. I'm going to try to do some speed talking. If I go too fast, stop me. First, let me start off. How many people here are PhD students? Wow. All right. We might have a 50-50. How many people are master's students? Are there any MFAs in the room? DMA. All right. So let's see. How many students are first year? How many students are other years? All right, so those are the bad guys, we love them. So having said that, let me go into, since we have such a, we just had a phenomenal response to this. We initially had a room that was 80 people, and then that filled up on RSVPs, and then we actually had to, and Dr. Bordeaux had to beg, borrow, and steal to get a bigger room. It was 120 people, and I think that came up to 127, so we tried to get as many people as we can in the room. So since we have this crowd, I'm going to steal this time to tell you a little bit about the graduate school. Let's hope it works. Okay, so, well, let me start off telling you about the agenda. So today, the sort of things we want to do is we want to give you an impression of how to get started. So this is targeted to the first year, but there will be other years that are not quite to the point where they're doing research. So we want to talk a little bit about, for one, the graduate school actually manages the production of your dissertation or thesis. So Ms. Doreen Yamamoto is going to give you an idea what the template is. She's going to go through the process. She's phenomenal. You get to work with her if you're doing a thesis or dissertation, so she'll be coming up next. Responsible conduct of research, that's a lot, that's very important about how you engage in research in ways that are most appropriate. So we're going to have a program to talk about that and get you prepared in that area. The RRB, I don't know if anyone here does behavioral or social behavioral research. Anyone's been involved with the IRB yet? Okay, so these folks will get sort of be sustained in what they already know, and then the rest of you get some introduction of what that is. Finally, we have a lunch prepared, and you might get 30 minutes break, maybe, if we can catch up. And then you'll have a chance to get to hear from some of your peers, and they're going to talk about, these are ones that we handpicked, students that have been very successful in research, and they're going to give you some idea how they jump-started their research careers. I hope to give a couple of comments myself, and then we'll close an evaluation. Tell us what you like, tell us what you don't like, because we are going to try this again next year. We're hoping to kind of fill the schedule with things that are most effective for you. All right, so let me tell you about graduate education. So first, let me congratulate you for your infinite wisdom in choosing a graduate school like the University of Miami. So I came here from Georgetown and Notre Dame, and I think I found the nirvana in the University of Miami, and I think you have made a wise decision coming. So we have 12 schools and colleges, which means we're really diverse, very comprehensive. We have just about every program you can imagine. If you take Georgetown and Notre Dame, for example, and you combine them together, we still have more schools and colleges here and more programs. So you can really kind of weave in and out of programs and kind of customize your engagement here at the University of Miami like no other school. So I think that's one of the significant advantages of being here. We have masters, LLMs, MBAs, PhDs, JDs, MDs, DMAs. So we have a large number, I don't think I got them all up here, but 155 plus graduate programs. This is us, oops, let's see, one of these is a pointer probably. But this is us at the parade. I don't know if anyone got a chance to participate in the parade this year, but it's our first year with at least a convertible. So had a large turnout and just a number of programs. I'm gonna talk about the ones that we started this year. All right, so Like I said, I have some visions when I came in. The things that I liked about the University of Miami that made it very attractive as a place to be dean. Number one is that I think we're a leader in globally diversity-enriched graduate education. So if you think about what I mean about that is that when you come here, you're actually studying amongst people from all over the world, from different languages, different cultures. So even if you don't go to this other country, because you're engaging with other people from these countries, I think you're really in a global, you're sitting on a global platform that you can use, and actually it's going to flavor the way you engage in research. So I think, and the university has been phenomenal in actually increasing that diversity while still maintaining the quality. As you know, as one measure of that is just our rankings in the U.S. News. So if you look at this, this on the bottom left-hand corner, the table, that big bar all the way to the left, that's diversity at University of Miami, and that's all the other aspirational peers. So if you, I think we're about 33% in unrepresented minorities as compared to all the other schools that are kind of in our same band. So we're head and shoulders above that in international diversity, all those things. I already told you about our programmatic diversity. So it's just a really rich environment for which to do to engage in your studies. I think we're at the forefront of customized contemporary education. University of Miami is only 80 years old. It sounds like it's older than I am, but if you consider the fact that our peers are 300 and 400 years old, we are a young institution, and by doing that, we are not steeped in this tradition that prevents us from doing some really neat things. So one of the things that I think was really neat on the undergraduate side is they have this thing called Cognates, where undergrad students don't have to take a set general requirements like other institutions. You can kind of say, I want this, I want this, I want this, I want this, and this is my, you know, core requirement. So if you look at the graduate, we're thinking maybe we can do something a lot about that around our graduate programs. We were thinking about things like group dissertations, like if you specialize in an area and you generalize in an area that's a different field, maybe your chapter is a chapter in someone else's specialization in that field. So we thought that might be interesting for a group of fellowships in the coming years. And we just have phenomenal programs. Community well-being, which really has PhD students that look at the betterment of our community, and not particularly going to academia, but looking at leading foundations. We have architecture here. The architecture in Miami and in Caribbean countries is very different than other places. So they're looking at ways to architect sustainability. And then we have a number of new master's and executive programs and MBA program that are just different than what you would normally see at other places. Finally, just comprehensive. We have just about every professional school. I don't know if that's, sometimes that comes at a fault because, you know, we have so much and we're trying to do a lot, and we're trying to do it with probably not the same resources that maybe a Princeton or Harvard have, but I think we do it well. And I think you guys are should feel very proud that you are in this situation. All right, so let me tell you, the graduate school, we do four basic things. One is, we oversee all of the program reviews each year. So we look at your programs and look for ways to strategically move them forward, move the needle so that your programs have better programs, have stronger faculty, the administration is better. So we look at every six programs a year, and we have to go through 60 different reviews in 7 years, or 5 to 7 years. So that's one thing. Two is that when new programs come, we actually have leadership of the graduate council and graduate faculty. So if there's a new master's program, PhD program, certificate program, that comes to us first. Third, as you guys may know, we actually are the unit that strategically guides the placement of assistantships, be it research assistantships or teaching assistantships or fellowships, internal, external fellowships. Our office is actually the office that oversees that budget. So we are looking for ways to kind of maximize that. As a person deeply interested in advancement, I look for donors to give us more money to have more discretionary fellowships in different areas like international education and areas specific to our strategic mission here. And then finally, we just have a number of central programs. So this is one of our central professional development programs. And this year, we made a concerted effort to go forward and say, look, how can we make this program repeatable, comprehensive, and more effective for you? So I'm going to give you highlights of that. Okay, so this is sort of the year in review this year, and a lot, I mean, Dr. Corinne Bordeaux is our associate dean, and she actually has more or less envisioned this new program, and we have really just, this year we've been really scurrying to try to get new programs, to evaluate them, and figure out what we want to do from year to year. So here are a couple pictures. Some of the things that we've done, we always have an open house and orientation. We did that's getting bigger and bigger every year. I think the numbers were above 200 this year. We had a brand new fellowship writing clinic. Anyone get a chance to go to either the program manager visits or actually participate in the clinic? Raise a show of hands. Cool. So that's a good deal. We participated in the homecoming parade. We had a teaching assistant workshop, dissertation writing group, and dissertation writing retreat. So most of these things, I'd say 4 out of 6 are new this year. So, and we've just been so appreciative of this group of actually being acceptive of these new programs that we've started. And I don't think I can go through all of this, but this is a screenshot of the calendar that's on our website. This calendar represents us demonstrating, trying to put maybe 4 to 6 different new things every month. And we want to do the same types of events on the same months every year. So you can decide, okay, I missed it this year, but I know it's coming back around next year. So just to give you a sense, in August we have our orientation. In September we are going to probably coin that as the month where we do visits from off-site external program managers for fellowships. We also are going to start our dissertation writing group in September and a TA development workshop in the beginning of the year in September. And this is going to be hard to read, so I'll try to capture this. In October, we'll actually have the early submission clinic for our fellowships. As you can see, the orange makes it hard to read, but basically what we're trying to say is that not only do we want to do our own events, but we want to be the central place on campus that helps you understand all of the events around graduate education. So the orange things are things that we're promoting, but are being organized or executed by a different office. So in September, like I said, October, like I said, is the fellowship writing clinic. We actually have where you turn in your applications early, we review them, and then if you go through the process, we like to give a small honorarium. I think we gave $100 or $150 this year to people who went through the whole process. In November, that's when we're actually doing a number of things. So our dissertation writing retreat, obviously the graduate school alumni parade is that time, and then we do receptions with the Florida Education Fund where we kind of more or less try to show appreciation for those groups that gives us external funding. In January, which is right now, we actually had some training around sexual harassment awareness. And then we obviously have this first year research guide. TOPO has been doing a phenomenal partnership with us in doing a lot of different events for graduate students. And then finally, as we move forward, there are things we haven't done yet. So in February, we're hoping to team with TOPO to do the graduate school's specific career symposium. And then in March and April, as you can see, what's coming up, we're hoping to do a graduate research symposium. And I'd like to do that in sort of like a flash mob type of way where we actually set up posters in different places around campus so that we can get, contact as many faculty administrative students as we can. And then we'll have some distinguished mentor lectures. We're hoping to start a new graduate school awards program where we award the best dissertation, the strongest new alumni, the best graduate program director, and things like that. And we're teaming with other campuses to do other types of events. So these are kind of a highlight. I went through this very fast, but as you can see, we're actually trying to develop a community that supports you. All right, having said that, let me introduce the people who make all this work. Dr. Corinne Bedeau, like I said, she's associate dean in the graduate school. She's actually in charge of our professional development calendar. She helps with grievances. She does everything. Mr. Rodrigo Gibson, we're fortunate to have him. He actually did a lot of work around planning this. He's a communication assistant in the graduate school. He pretty much makes us look good. Mr. Tyrone Henry, you would have had some contact with him. He actually handles a lot of the academic forms. He deals with clearances. He's the person that will get you graduated. He interacts with the department. So again, he does most of the things that actually keep the trains moving on time. Ms. Nicole Johnson, she's office assistant. She also does similar things as Mr. Henry as far as keeping the trains moving on time. Ms. Angela Marte, she deals with the money. She's our budget director, and you would have interacted. If you had a fellowship, you interacted with her. Finally, Mrs. Maria Torres, she's executive assistant, so she pretty much partners with me to kind of continue the mission of the graduate school and also leading the graduate council. And you are going to meet Ms. Doreen Yamamoto, who is our senior dissertation editor, and she's actually going to give you sort of an insight on completing your dissertation. So I think that's all I have. That is it. And at this point, if there are any questions, I think I went a little long, so I'll take any quick questions you may have. And I'm going to thank you again for coming. and I'm going to, hopefully, our program you enjoy. So at this point, I'm going to ask Mr. Rin Yamamoto to come up and present.
Hi, good morning. I'm Doreen Yamamoto, the dissertation editor at the Graduate School. I'll be working with many of you later during your time here at UM when you're ready to prepare your thesis or your dissertation for submission. This morning, we wanted to give you a brief heads up about what lies ahead concerning the submission of your thesis or dissertation, which will be in electronic form, not hard copy. When preparing your dissertation or thesis, your committee's job will be to guide you through your research and help you prepare the content of the document. My job will be to help you create a final electronic thesis or dissertation that's formatted to graduate school specifications and is suitable for upload to the database. The final document will be in PDF form. The PDF will be uploaded to UM's scholarly repository, which is a database that houses all UM theses and dissertations. You'll find all the information you need to know about how to submit your document on the ETD website. Can we go back to that other slide? Oh, back. Right. The ETD website's address is miami.edu/ETD. And on that website, you will find the deadline, submission instructions, front matter templates that you need to use in your document, the formatting guidelines that the graduate school requests you follow in your document, and any forms that also need to be submitted to complete your submission. The next one. This is a screenshot of the landing page of our website. At the bottom of the landing page, you'll see there's a calendar. That calendar tells you in each semester what the various deadlines are that you need to be aware of. It's best to know what these deadlines are well in advance of the date in which you plan to graduate so that you can plan ahead. And a word to the wise is planning ahead will really enable you to experience a relatively hassle-free submission process. So just click on the tab when you think you're going to graduate and follow those deadlines. You'll notice on this landing page on the left, there's also a menu that will walk you through each step of the submission process. For example, if you click on item number one before writing, you will access the next page where you can download all the information you need to know when you start to write. You can download underneath ETD process. The ETD process guidelines are the instructions for how to submit. It's in PDF form, which can be downloaded and printed out. Underneath that is the organization and formatting guidelines document, which is also downloadable and printable. And there's also the visit to the scholarly repository is a link that will take you to the scholarly repository so that you can view documents that have already been submitted by former students. Underneath that is in the large orange colored rectangle that says templates and formatting guidelines guide. If you click on that, it will take you to a page where you can access the front matter templates that I mentioned. We have Word document front matter templates that you must use for each degree, Master of Arts, Master of Science, MFAs, PhDs, and DMA. If you go back to the landing page again, you'll notice step number two, before defense, which takes you to a page where you should complete the defense notice form. Can we go two more? This is the page that it will take you to, where you'll find the defense notice form. And there are fields here that you type in the information. This is the field, the page for the defense notice form. You type in all the information about yourself and the date of your defense and the location. And at the bottom, you There's a button you click. You can print this page out. You'll need to have it initialed by your committee chair, and then you just submit it to the graduate school so that we can announce the date of your defense and the location, since it is a public event. And you should do that as soon as you know what the date and the location of your defense are. Okay. Let me go back again to the landing page. Back to the landing page, you'll notice that the three remaining items, number 3, number 4, and number 5, on this menu, will provide just various documents for download that you'll need over the course of this process. Information about how to submit the document to me for review after you've defended, and what final materials you'll need to complete and turn into the graduate school after you've completed your final document and uploaded that to the scholarly repository. So this morning, I only wanted to give you a brief introduction to the process of how to submit your thesis or dissertation when the time comes. And I look forward to working with many of you one-on-one when the time comes for you to submit your thesis or dissertation. That's it.
Thank you, Doreen, and thank you, Dean Blake, for getting a sense of who's in the room, right? So we know we wanted to make this available to first-year students. We had some emails, some calls from second-year students, but we have some students that are further along the way. And I, too, wanted to take this opportunity to give you a sense of some of the programming that might be really related to the writing of your dissertation that you'd be interested in participating during your time here. So the ETD Resources Across Campus, Electronic Thesis and Dissertation Resources Across Campus, is a workshop that we'll be holding next month. You'll start to get more annoying, perhaps, emails from me about that very soon. And we'll spend a bit more time talking about what are the resources on campus available at the library, the Writing Center, and a bit as well at the Graduate School in more detail that will assist you with getting the writing aspect of your work done. Or if there's a special resource, a special database, a collection that you need access to in the library, whether it's here at the University of Miami or otherwise, we'll have folks in the library that assist you with that. And there's also a digital media lab that supports some of the technical aspects of the requirements of submitting your ETD. And again, that's going to be later down the line for most of you. But it's a good idea if you're available to attend early in your semester, you get a chance to schedule when you want to access some of these resources as you're planning to complete the writing part of your dissertation. The dissertation writing group and the dissertation writing retreat are also two initiatives that, as you're closer to the end of your process, or if you're actually maybe writing articles that for publication that will contribute to your dissertation, or writing research that will help you in preparation for your individual project, that I encourage you to keep an eye out for as well. We mentioned that the call for the dissertation writing group comes out once a year in the fall, but that group meets once a week throughout each semester, fall, spring, through the completion of their project. So it's a really small, intimate group. Again, they meet weekly, they review each other's work, and they really just kind of make sure that you're on track and help you to maintain a regular writing schedule. The dissertation writing retreat is another program that is new. We did it for the first time in the fall. We had a really good retreat response, and I think we have a couple people in the room that participated. Did I see? No. Is there anyone who's in the dissertation writing group here? Yes, that's what I saw. Right. So we have members of the dissertation writing group, and hopefully some of you will also participate in the writing retreat, which is a more condensed experience. But we spend about 3 or 4 days in a room much like this. And in the morning, we get in really early. We make sure that you're nourished for the day. You write. We have lunch where we have a technical workshop. And again, we reflect on the writing process and identify any challenges that you might have that keep you from making progress with your dissertation. So again, I wanted to give you just a heads up about these opportunities and encourage you to respond when you hear calls for participation. I also wanted to give you maybe a sneak peek. We can't give you a sneak peek, but we can tell you that right now the website is a place that you can go to access some of the templates that Doreen mentioned. So again, you can go there and download the actual Word document that you can use to start in the correct format that you'll need to have for to meet the requirements of the graduate school. So I'm not talking about content-wise, which your faculty are going to tell you and over and over and over again to redo, but what Doreen is going to be looking at before you submit the document to the repository that you mentioned. But we're working on a platform that might be able to have a more individualized experience for you so that we can have electronic documents shared with you all, again, as you begin your process, give you the calendars with dates that might be relevant to the time that you're actually finishing and working toward your dissertation and graduation completion. And so again, that's another thing to kind of look forward to, heads up, that we hope that you will appreciate and to support you in your writing. Did you want to introduce Reed and Anita? Any? Okay. All right, so we're going to go back to the program and ask Dean Blake to introduce our next speakers as I chat with them outside there.
So again, our next event, I'm going to make sure I get the titles right, but our next panel is going to be on the responsible conduct of research. And the two that are going to do it are Dr. Reed Cushman. He actually mainly works on the medical center, but he's actually the one in charge of actually our compliance with RCR with regards to our sponsored research. And he's currently the RCR Program Director for Research Ethics, Consultations, and Service Co-Director. And Dr. Anita Kava, she actually does our initial one in the for our graduate student orientation early in the year. She's Associate Professor of Business Law. She's kind of a lawyer, and she's in the business school, so that's sort of a scary combination. So, but she knows so much about it. You're going to enjoy hearing from her and from Reed. Thanks so much.